Jack, that was brilliant.
Absolutely brilliant.
Merry Christmas to you.
Oh, he's so cute.
Isn't he, Jess?
So cute. You were cute like that one. You could once sing that high tune.
Yes, I know. Those were the days, eh? He'll be presenting Breakfast in about 30 years.
He might be. Got a new single out as well, hasn't he?
Yes.
The Christmas single.
Yes, and it's called Tomorrow.
It's and in it's the shop, all going to charity as well, which is fantastic.
Good on him. Brilliant voice.
Right, still to come this morning, Hollywood's most overpaid stars, Ross King, is telling us all.
Yeah, that's after the latest competition. The biggest one out for us,
biggest
isn't it?
One ever,
it's a messenger for you.
I love getting ready for Christmas, and our amazing prize will definitely put you in the festive mood. First up, there's an amazing £60,000 cash. And £60,000 is just the first Christmas wish we're making come true. You could also have these two cars parked outside your house. Car number one is this Mercedes E350 Estate. It comes with lots of extras, including DAB radio, heated front seats, and AMG sports package. And over here is car number two. This actual Mini Cooper could be the little family runaround. And come this way, take a look under the tree. You'll also get all of these gifts as well, including the latest iPhones, a Victoria Beckham handbag, a Prada laptop case and wallet, £1,000 to spend in Selfridges, kitchen goodies and lots more. So that's the amazing £60,000, the Mercedes, the Mini and the gifts under the tree for your chance to win the lot. Text the word HOLLY to 82248. Call 090 41 61 9000. Text costs £1.50 plus one standard network rate message. Calls cost no more than £1.54 from BT Landline. Other networks may be higher and mobiles considerably more. Or enter for free at itv.com. Entrance must be 18 or over. Entries made after lines close at midday on Tuesday the 24th of December will not be counted but may still be charged. Good luck.
Good luck with that. Yes. Over to Ross now in LA for all the Hollywood news. And we start, Ross, with the world's most overpaid film stars. They've kind of worked it out mathematically, haven't they?
Yes. It could actually have been me if you'd seen any of the movies I'd ever done, although I was only paid £1.50, but that was far, far more than I was actually ever worth. Yet Forbes' top 10 list of the overpaid actors, they base it on how much you get paid and how much money you actually make back. Now, the bottom line is there's a lot of surprises here. Have a look at some of the names that feature. You will be surprised. Ryan Reynolds is in there. So is Matt Damon. You've even got Jennifer Aniston. Denzel Washington, who'd have thought it, and Nicolas Cage too. But let me give you the top three and give you the actual dollar amounts. In third place, Reese Witherspoon, but without a spadeful of money. For every dollar that she got you back $3.90. In second place, Katherine Heigl, So for every dollar, you got back $3.50. And of course, she was a huge star at Grey's Anatomy. And everyone thought she was going to have this big movie career. Hasn't quite worked. There's been all sorts of stories about being a bit difficult to work with. But in number one, and this will surprise certainly plenty of Americans out here, number one, it is Adam Sandler, the most overpaid actor, according to the Forbes list. For every dollar, $3.40 you get back. And one of the movies that did really badly for him, Jack and Jill, or as they called it out here, Cack and Jill. Just hasn't been that funny of late, but you know he'll come back.
Nice joke. Ross, our very own One Direction have been in the States. They're recruiting new members.
They certainly are. One Direction now, Nine Direction, with a little help from Saturday Night Live, the big show on a Saturday night out here, and the stars of Anchorman 2. Check them out. And Niall Soinawad even posted some pics of him with the gang too. Excellent stuff. Well done, boys.
Yeah. That movie was very strange. It was very strange, yes. And quite bizarre, the new one. Now, what's all this about a fight between Damian Lewis, who we know, of course, from Homeland, and Sir Ian McKellen? What's going on?
It's kind of handbags at 50 paces, let's be honest here. Damien was saying that when he was in his 20s and he was doing a lot of theatre, he was concerned that he would never actually move out of the theatre world and he was going to become one of those slightly over-the-top actors with a fruity kind of a voice, you know, an illustrious career on the stage, but no film work till he's in his 50s, and then he'd have to become a wizard. So, of course, people were saying, oh, was that Sir Ian? And then when it was put to Sir Ian, he said, so he feels sorry for me? Well, I'm very happy. He needn't worry about me at all. I think all is fine there. I don't think anyone needs to worry about them at all. And also, I'll see you later with Tom Hanks, Emma Thompson, as I take you to the premiere of Saving Mr. Banks out here in LA.
Oh, look forward to that. Thank you very much indeed. Now, I've just noticed that in Antarctica, it's minus 95. Yes, it's a record low temperature in East Antarctica. So even though it might be a little bit chilly today, it's never going to be that bad, is it, Laura?
Crikey, goodness, no. Thank goodness, no. The coldest temperature ever recorded on Earth is minus 98, so they are just that close away from it. Thankfully, though, it's a much milder start to the day across most of the UK. We bring our weather to you this morning from Chatsworth House, transformed into the magical land of Narnia. We've even got the lamppost where the children used to meet Mr. Tumnus. So, magical land of Narnia, the weather not looking too magical. Let's take a look.
Daybreak National Weather, in association with Topps Tiles. Brightening your home, whatever the weather.
Not very magical, but pretty settled, you'll be pleased to hear, with some decent sunshine for most of us today. A lot of dry weather. Not so for the northwest. It'll be cloudy with some rain at times. Now, there's patchy rain for the northwest of Scotland at the moment. Also very cloudy here this morning, which means it's really, really mild at the moment. Temperature 7 or 8 degrees. It is clear and cold, though, in the south with a touch of frost and some fog. Dense in places, it could cause some travel delays, but it will readily clear this morning. By this afternoon, England and Wales, some decent sunny spells, dry with light winds. Scotland and Northern Ireland, the northwest, will turn cloudier and breezier today, but it will be mild wherever you are. Tonight into tomorrow, clearer skies will move into England and Wales, and here we have beautiful sunshine tomorrow.
For your local five-day weather update, go to our website, itv.com/daybreak.
And it's our little Rachel's final show, so we're wishing her all the best for the future. She'll be able to watch tomorrow's show on it. Hollywood star Steve Carell joins us live in the studio ahead of the release of Anchorman 2.
And after the break, a packed show including Corrie's Julie, that's actress Katie Kavanagh, is here live. Loads more. See you in a minute. Hello, good morning to you. On today's show, facing the worst week of her life, we'll find out why Coronation Street's Julie is in for a nasty shock. Actress Katie Kavanagh joins us at 9:10. Also on the programme, Susan Boyle's Asperger's admission. What does it mean for her career? That's in 10 minutes time. And at 9:00, all the news from last night's Hollywood premiere. We're back with our Ross in Los Angeles. And at 5...
Good morning. It is actually cold here in Los Angeles, but we've got coming up the stars of a movie that will not only warm your hands, warm your hearts too. It's Saving Mr. Banks. We've got Emma Thompson, Tom Hanks in 25 minutes time.
Fantastic. And at 5:00, just who are the Band of Sisters? We're going to be finding out with a special look inside the Recovery Centre for Britain's Injured Soldiers. before of that, though, let's begin, as usual, with a look at today's newspapers. The Mail's headline is Fleeced by the Pension Sharks. This is a new report that claims retired savers are paying excessive fees to those who manage their money. The Mirror reports on former X Factor judge Talisa, who's been charged over an alleged drugs deal. Her lawyer says she will fight to prove her innocence. Meanwhile, The Express reveals a so-called five-step cure for dementia, which are lifestyle changes that can stave off the disease, according to a new study. Well, Mark Durden-Smith, Katie Nicol are right here. We'll be looking through the rest of the papers in just a moment. First, though, let's get the latest on the big story this morning that's happening right now in South Africa. These are live pictures from Johannesburg at the football stadium, where a huge memorial service to Nelson Mandela gets underway in around 25 minutes' time. Our Richard Gaisford is there and has just sent us this report.
Well, it's been quite a morning already, and the service is still to start in half an hour's time. This driving wind and rain hasn't put people off. Nearly 100,000 people will eventually be inside this stadium here in Soweto. And the scenes as they've come in, well, it's been quite incredible. The singing, the dancing, the chanting, they are all here desperate to give their thanks for Nelson Mandela's life. And inside, as the stadium fills up, the volume levels have been going up as well. People aren't that bothered, really, about the world leaders who are coming, although they're pleased to know that Barack Obama has landed in South Africa, will be in the stadium soon. We've seen Winnie Mandela, Nelson Mandela's second wife, arrive in the stadium. And also David Cameron, the British Prime Minister, along with three former Prime Ministers, coming into the stadium and starting to talk to people. But it is really all about the family. It is about people coming together to pay their respects. And we're going to have four of Nelson Mandela's grandchildren taking to the stage, the same stage that President Barack Obama will use, and the President of South Africa, to address not only the crowd here, but millions watching worldwide.
Thank you very much indeed, Richard. I'm just looking at the memorial service. I mean, although obviously he belongs to the world, you can see that his grandchildren are actually going to be making a tribute as well, and a tribute by the family, which I think is really lovely.
Yes.
I mean, that's what, and it is all about those people that are there, 100,000 of them and
it's
more.
Not ticketed, first come, first
yep.
serves. I mean, you just, I mean, I guess the whole thing, we run like clockwork, but
yes.
What an occasion. 7 hours. Your viewing figures might dip at 9 o'clock.
But only, yes, I know. But only Nelson Mandela could get such a... dispersed group, you know, together. When you
Absolutely.
Think about all that, there's no way that some of these world leaders would ever even be in the same room as one another. Now they're having to come together.
And I think, you know, that's a wonderful tribute to this man who did manage to bring a sense of togetherness to everything that he did. And it will be a huge audience. I mean, possibly bigger than the audience that tuned in to Princess Diana's funeral, which I think certainly in our living memory is probably the most significant funeral that we will remember. So it's going to be quite an occasion. But I think it's so wonderful that it's a celebration of his life. And as you saw from Richard's reports, the crowds cheering and dancing, you felt that it was a celebration. Mm. And then I think that's what he would have wanted.
Absolutely.
No, very much so. Very much so. Let's go back to the papers and the Telegraph warning about children and basically the lack of exercise. Now, we've talked about this before, haven't we? But
the report in the British Journal of Sports Medicine have basically accused successive governments of child neglect. They're saying that the lack of exercise in schools, the lack of promoting exercise in schools in our young, this is indistinguishable from their definition of child neglect. And actually, you do think, you know, the government says we put £300 million into primary school exercise post the Olympics as part of the legacy. There's £450 million pledged for future promotion of policy of exercise in schools. But actually, we're not doing enough. One in three primary school children leave school obese.
It's terrible, isn't it?
And you know, we can get on our high horse and they've got their targets to reach, but actually it should be prioritised, and at least 1 hour of exercise is what they're saying should be built into the curriculum. Mm. And I couldn't agree more, actually.
It is crazy.
You'd thought the Olympics would have spurred people on as well, wouldn't you?
I know, that's what we thought, and it doesn't seem to have happened at all. That bubble sort of burst.
Mm.
Now, nearly all the papers have got this horrible, it's actually terrifying picture of a burglary in process. It's just awful. Look at that.
Yes, this is a pensioner, 68-year-old Margaret Woodward, at her home in Derbyshire. I mean, it does send shivers up the spine, doesn't it? But the reason that the cameras are filming this is because she was broken into. This was the fifth occasion. Well, the advantage of having the cameras in was that we saw the offender's face, and he has now been jailed for four
Good.
And a half years, quite
Good.
Rightly so. But this incredible woman, who I don't know whether she wasn't well or she had trouble getting to her bed because obviously she's sleeping in her chair, woke up on this last occasion and chased him out with a stick, and you think, well, that's quite
fantastic.
Remarkable. But when you feel that violated in your own home, it's pretty pretty shocking.
And she got an award for bravery for that as
well. She did, didn't she?
Well,
from the Sheriff of Derbyshire. Yes, exactly. £1,500, which hopefully will help make things a little better.
I hope so. Now, we know it's school nativity season, do we not? Mm. The Mail is reporting just how far some parents will go to get their children the best roles.
Yes, they're saying that a new teacher called into a phone-in programme saying that she was bribed by one of the mothers with beauty treatments for her daughter to be playing the part of Mary. Now, I think that's far too obvious. Do it by stealth.
You know,
get your little child to go to school in, you know, with a baby in swaddling clothes and just subliminal messages. Or, I mean, I've actually been through this. You haven't quite yet. You're sort of almost in nativity age.
I got Mary before. I didn't have to bribe.
Head girl,
I got
Mary.
Lady, of course.
But I would actually bribe them not to make them the lead parts. We actually had shepherds who were promoted to two of the three wise men. I've got twin sons. And they threw their frankincense at myrrh at the baby Jesus and then got naked down to their pants.
Oh,
and so I'm saying, if you're a parent, be careful for what you wish for, because it may come back to haunt you.
But I like that nativity place when it all goes wrong. It's adorable, absolutely adorable. Now, look,
horrifying.
Prepare to groan. It's still sticking with the Christmas theme. The Mirror has got all the latest Christmas cracker jokes. They are rubbish.
But I thought they were quite good.
But old ones are rubbish, new ones are rubbish. They have to be rubbish.
Oh, well,
it's fine.
I take great delight in you know, riffing over the crack, and we always read the jokes around our table, and we always groan. But a new channel, Gold, have come up with the initiative to launch a competition to try and get some better jokes on this little
modern
piece of paper.
Right. Okay.
Yeah, so there was one that I particularly like, because, of course, it has a royal theme. What does the Queen call the Christmas broadcast?
What is it? I don't know.
Come on, you've got to give us the punchline.
The One Show! Oh,
the One Show!
I quite like that. You see, I thought that was quite good.
But top of their list was, what does Miley Cyrus have at Christmas? Twerky.
Mm.
But I think the oldest one are the best. The whole report is saying that the old ones are rubbish, but I think they are the greatest. For instance, what is Santa's favourite pizza? One that's deep pan, crisp and even.
I'm groaning. Now, look, we mentioned the Queen and the Queen's joke.
Yes.
Finally, it has been revealed what the Queen carries in her handbag.
I know, it's
allegedly.
It's what we all want to know, isn't it? The mints, the compact and the lipstick. Well, I think we knew about that, but apparently she keeps little charms in there of dogs and horses because she believes that they bring them luck.
Oh,
which I thought was quite interesting.
£5
note for the church collection. But the handbag is so useful, not obviously to hold those important things, but when the Queen has had enough, when one has had enough, one pops her handbag on the table and that is a signal... We're off.
So one puts the handbag on the table and then everybody knows.
Yeah, it's time for the Queen to leave.
She moves it from left arm to right arm.
When she wants
to move on from whoever she's talking to. If she whacks
them
around the head with it, she's really peed off.
I love her even more now. I think that's really brilliant.
When she's handbagging you, that is the time to... The memo about blue today was actually worked. Royal Navy blue.
Yes, indeed.
Thank you. We'll see you later. Thank you very much. As always, we want to hear from you, of course. We're talking about the parent who tried to bribe a teacher so her daughter got the best role in the school nativity. Outrageous. What do you think? What role did your children get? Were you happy about it? What were the costumes like? We want to hear your Christmas cracker jokes as well. Your favourite? Doesn't have to be all that funny. You can message us on Facebook, tell us on Twitter, or if you're over 18, do text 67890. It'll cost you 25 pence, plus that standard network charge. Right, we're talking about why Susan Boyle's making headlines in just a moment. First, though, you could win our biggest prize ever, worth £130,000. Melinda Messenger has all the details.
I love getting ready for Christmas, and our amazing prize will definitely put you in the festive mood. First up, there's an amazing £60,000 cash. And £60,000 is just the first Christmas wish we're making come true. You could also have these two cars parked outside your house. Car number one is this Mercedes E350 Estate. It comes with lots of extras, including DAB radio, heated front seats, and AMG sports package. And over here is car number two. This actual Mini Cooper could be the little family runaround. And come this way, take a look under the tree. You'll also get all of these gifts as well, including the latest iPhones, a Victoria Beckham handbag, a Prada laptop case and wallet, £1,000 to spend in Selfridges, kitchen goodies and lots more. So that's the amazing £60,000, the Mercedes, the Mini and the gifts under the tree for your chance to win the lot. Text the word HOLLY to 82248. Call 090 41 61 9000. Text costs £1.50 plus one standard network rate message. Calls cost no more than £1.54 from BT Landline. Other networks may be higher and mobiles considerably more. Or enter for free at itv.com. Entrance must be 18 or over. Entries made after lines close at midday on Tuesday the 24th of December will not be counted but may still be charged. Good luck.
Now, we're talking now about one of the UK's most successful female singers.
Have yourself a merry little Christmas. Let your heart be light.
Of course, it's Susan Boyle, a huge success, but someone who's publicly struggled with fame. And now, thanks to a brave admission, we know why. Susan's revealed this week that she has Asperger's syndrome, and since her diagnosis a year ago, she says she's been learning to manage her condition alongside a demanding career. Not easy, but just what does that involve? Well, I'm joined now by Sarah Hewitt, who was diagnosed with Asperger's when she was 26, and she's here with Dr. Hillary. Thank you for coming in. And 26, I mean, when Susan was diagnosed, you know, she's in her 50s, her early 50s, that's late, but 26 is late as well. And I guess it just means that when you're growing up, you know there's something not quite right, but you don't know what it is. It must have been very difficult.
Yes, it was difficult, but as you say, I didn't know what the difficulties were. Yeah. So it was good to discover eventually that there was a reason for it. And importantly, because there was a reason for it, it meant it was possible for me to find strategies and learn how to deal with it.
And what sort of coping strategies then did you learn and that you use and presumably still use?
Well, a number of different things, really. So small talk, learning how to make small talk with people. This is very, very helpful in the workplace.
Of course.
I think I had to learn quite... I had to learn how to maintain appropriate eye contact, because for a long time I didn't realise people thought I was being very standoffish or being rude because I wasn't looking at them, or I would give across the impression I was bored, and that wasn't the case at all. But obviously this can be a bit of a problem in the workplace, say, when you're supposed to be engaging with people and, of course, making people feel as though you're making them feel interesting.
I can completely understand that, and that must be very difficult, because that's just something that we know to do. You know, we learn it, don't we, Hilary? Mm-hmm. We just do.
Yes. Yeah, but if you've
But if you've got Asperger's, you have to learn small talk. You're absolutely right. You have to learn eye contact. You have to be taught these things and always have them at the forefront of your mind. Mm-hmm. Do you think with Susan talking about this now, it will help other people? Do you think it's a good thing?
Absolutely. I mean, I think it's very important for people to have a role model, and I think clearly she's been extraordinarily successful in her career.
Yeah.
And I think we need to see more people on the spectrum with Asperger's syndrome, but with all kinds of disabilities
Exactly. Makes perfect sense. Yeah. And you live a very, very normal life. Married, very happy, good job.
It is possible, yes.
but you are, because I think sometimes people think, oh gosh, it's something to do with autism, therefore they maybe don't understand it as much.
Yes,
perhaps.
Yeah. On quite a number of occasions when people have heard, or when I've told them I have Asperger's syndrome, I get reactions like, oh no, how awful, or even on other occasions people thinking, surely not, you look perfectly normal. And I think we really need to do something to start busting these myths that there is a type of person who has Asperger's syndrome, because I think the stereotype really...
Well, you've just proved that there isn't one. You agree, Hilary?
Absolutely. I mean, it's fascinating about Susan Boyle coming out and saying, you know, she was diagnosed with this, because, you know, when we look back and we remember Amanda Holden's face and Simon Cowell's face when she was on stage, having been so socially inept and saying such almost inappropriate things, the shock on their faces when she came out with this wonderful singing was in huge contrast to the way she was perceived socially by everybody else. Mm-hmm. So that social inappropriateness, that frankness, in a way rudeness as it's interpreted, was very interesting. But she had this talent, which is
remained dormant for all those years because she'd been dismissed by the rest of society. And that's exactly what Asperger's is. This is about social, lack of social communication skills, failure to socially integrate, failure to maintain relationships because other people don't really understand what's going on in that person. But as we've seen, as Sarah said, with the right coping strategies and the right help and support, you know, people can lead very happy and fulfilling lives.
Of course they can. You've proved that. You really have. And thank you
usually
so
for
much.
Above average intelligence too, aren't
well
they?
That's the thing, and as we saw, but Susan, very very talented, very artistic also.
Absolutely.
Sometimes
you
can't
I mean
you can't generalize, can
we're
you?
Not all savants and not everyone has a photographic memory, but
it's all these perceptions.
We're
that
pretty
are...
normal people.
Exactly. Well, you've proved that. Thank you so much for coming in, and thank you,
you're
Lily,
welcome.
As always.
Thank you.
And after the break, introducing the band of sisters, finding out what Christmas holds for the families of soldiers injured on the front line, and still practically perfect in every way. We're on last night's red carpet with the stars of Mary Poppins, nearly 50 years on from that film. See you in a couple of minutes. That's Dick Van Dyke there. Gosh.
There for you, Lorien, sponsored by Spa.
Hi, welcome back. Still to come, is at the end of the road for Coronation Street's Julian Bryan. I'm going to be finding out from actress Katie Kavanagh. First though, with just 3 weeks to go before Christmas, we're meeting a very special group of women. This year, over 1,000 British soldiers will be spending the festive period recovering from injuries sustained on the front line. This morning, we've been given exclusive access to a Help for Heroes rehabilitation centre and spoken to the Band of Sisters, a support group for those whose loved ones have been hurt.
If you're having a really down day, you can just phone them up and they're there at the end of the phone.
Especially at Christmas time, it's just we remember what we're thankful for.
We have all experienced the same journey.
Fighting the Taliban was the easiest part. Coming home was the hardest.
Band of sisters, everybody's in the same boat. I met Josh after his injury. He lost both his legs, he's a double amputee above knee. You speak to some people and they don't understand, and they can look at you as if you're being mean or you're not the one that's lost their legs. And when people around you understand you, it makes life a lot easier.
On June the 7th, 2007, I was injured by being shot in the spine by a sniper. I was rendered paralysed from the waist down to start with. Over the months and years that followed, I was able to get back up on my legs. This is almost like a safety net.
It is, it
so
is.
So that if you, are, if you are having a bad day, you can ring people up. You've got all these people there who will understand, and that's important, especially coming up to the Christmas period.
When the illness and struck and then the following brain injury, Gerald lost all his memory. This Christmas for us is going to be really very difficult because I'm not English, so I've got the other thing that, you know, family for me is not here. You may be at the very beginning of the journey and you might think, how am I going to get through this? But meet somebody who is much further down the journey and tells you, oh, it is possible.
Yeah, basically so. When I became a single parent, I was made aware of a Band of Sisters. Around Christmas, it's a real close family period. It's just nice you can hang around with other kids whose parents have been through the same experiences that, you know, he has.
It made me feel like I'm not alone, so technically I'm not the only person with an injured dad or an injured parent.
Yeah.
Well, Ella and Louise, who we saw in that film there, join us now. A bit emotional watching that, wasn't it?
Just a bit.
Yeah, just a little bit. Your men are extraordinary. I mean, to have the tenacity that they've got to bounce back from such severe injuries. But it would, I have to say, they wouldn't be able to do it if it wasn't for you two. If it wasn't for, you know, if it wasn't for the women in their lives or their partners, they wouldn't be able to do it.
I don't think we'd be able to do it without each other, though.
Yeah, it's that support, isn't it? It's that support. And how important is it to have the Band of Sisters there?
It's so important. Like, it's the most precious gift, like, having true friends that understand you and understand your specific situation. So if you're having a really bad day or a good day or a terrible day, you always have someone that can go, actually, I've been there and it gets better. Or, you know, just hang on, I'm here. Or, you know, just have a little cuddle.
I think as well, especially with
the actual staff being
amazing.
Just absolutely, you walk in and they just hug you, and also them knowing, especially Ali, who's been through it.
Oh, I know. Yes.
You know, she's amazing. It's really different to have that.
No, I've been there myself, brilliant. And it's just, it is like a little haven, isn't it? You just feel, it actually makes you feel kind of safe, and you're allowed to cry, and you're allowed to say,
encouraged.
And you're actually allowed to be cross. Because that's the thing as well, I thought was really interesting, because, you know, you can't treat the men like they're made out of crystal. They don't want that. No. You know, you should be able to shout at them and get annoyed with them, and the normal things that happen in a marriage or relationship. And that's, but that must be quite difficult. You know, when they're struggling and they're having a bad time, it's quite
the thing
hard.
I find really hard is, John was shot through the spine, so he has shrapnel in his spine still. So he gets neuropathic pain, which is basically the really bad kind of pain that just doesn't go away until it goes away. Yeah. And watching someone you love in like indescribable pain is absolute agony for me. But if I've had a really bad day, I can snap at him, and then I'll walk out and I'll feel really guilty and I'll feel awful, and I'll be like, I'm such a bad person. I can't believe I just snapped at him. Like, he fought for my freedom. How dare I snap at him? And then I can just like ring up Lou or Anna or one of my friends, or go and see like the girls at Tedworth House and basically have a cuddle, and they go, actually, no, it's fine. Like, tomorrow's a different day. Like, it doesn't matter. It's absolutely fine.
And it's perfectly normal to feel like that. In fact, they wouldn't want to be you to be tippy-toeing round all the time, would they?
You've kind of got to make some normality, as normal as it's going to be, because obviously their life is totally different. Yeah.
Especially for you and your kids. Like,
no, definitely.
Just need a normal house, don't you?
No, exactly.
And you've just, you've got me tiny baby and everything.
So cute.
the cutest baby I've ever seen. So gorgeous. I mean, absolutely gorgeous. And somehow you've got to sort of get your family back to normal.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a different normality, isn't it?
No, definitely.
It's a totally different normality. And of course, there's going to be men coming back with post-traumatic stress as well. You know, that's going to be really tough too. So what they're doing there, what Help for Heroes are doing, is just amazing.
Oh, it's essential.
Amazing.
Yeah.
I guess you couldn't do without them.
Oh, absolutely couldn't do without them. I wouldn't want to be honest. Absolutely wouldn't want to.
I'm really fortunate because I work at Tedworth House, so it's just seeing the guys are just inspirational.
They are. Completely.
Absolutely, just watching them. I work in the gym, so it's just brilliant because I can look. I'm just watching them. I'm like, oh my gosh, I can't even do that.
No.
And I've got all my limbs.
Exactly.
You know, it's just phenomenal. Absolutely phenomenal.
It's incredible. It's great. Thank you both so much for coming in. Have the best Christmas.
Thank you. It's just so good
to see you. Thank you. And the great work that's done there. Thank you very much indeed. Right, still to come between now and 9:25, the inside story on a dramatic week in Corrie. Actress Katie Kavanagh tells us why it's crunch time for Julie and Brian. She's here in 10 minutes. And up next, our Ross is standing by in Los Angeles.
Yes, morning, Lorraine. Someone has left a wee message on Simon Cowell's carpet. Yes, everyone's a critic. Plus, our biggest star, Emma Thompson, up against America's biggest star, Tom Hanks. The result coming up.
Thank you, Ross. Right now, though, it's just 1 minute after nine. Let's get the news from Ranveer.
Good morning. A memorial service for Nelson Mandela is about to get underway in Johannesburg. 95,000 people, including presidents and prime ministers, are gathering to see the historic ceremony. Millions will watch on television across the world. Our chief correspondent Richard Gaisford is there.
But with minutes to go until the scheduled start of this service, you can see that many of the seats are still empty here inside the stadium. It seems to be taking longer than perhaps people thought to get people in. They are filing into the stadium slowly. Many, though, have been in place for the last few hours, singing, chanting and dancing. Spirits are certainly high here. Big cheers ring out whenever anyone famous appears on the big screen. Although what people are really here for is to celebrate the life of Nelson Mandela, to give thanks and praise for what he has done for them. We've seen many people walking from the streets of Soweto here to the stadium today. They're thanking him for the freedom and the equality he delivered, for taking them out of apartheid. And it is going to be quite a service. It's going to last 4 hours, and that's if it runs on time.
Richard Gaisford there. Shocking pictures of a burglar repeatedly breaking into a pensioner's home have been released after the man was jailed. Police installed hidden cameras when Margaret Woodward's flat was broken into several times. As you can see, Patrick Reed was filmed creeping around her home. Senior officials from five leading sports have been called to a summit with the government to discuss ways of tackling match fixing. Football, tennis, cricket, rugby union and rugby league will be represented at the talks with the Culture Secretary Maria Miller. It follows the arrest of six people during an investigation to spot fixing in football, including Blackburn striker DJ Campbell. Today's weather for you, it'll be dry with bright spells in most areas, but damp and windy in the northwest. Top temperature, very mild, 14 Celsius. That's it from me. It's 3 minutes past nine. Now back to Lorraine.
We'll be talking to Cory's Julie very shortly. First of all, let's catch up with our Ross King in Los Angeles, where Emma Thompson and Tom Hanks were on the red carpet just a few hours ago. Hi, Ross. Big, big premiere overnight, wasn't it?
It certainly was. It was on the Disney lot, and it's always magical just going on that lot. You go, you know, little boy from Glasgow, and you go, oh, my goodness me, this is where the magic happens. And it did happen again tonight. Tom Hanks was there, Emma Thompson too, Saving Mr. Banks, who, of course, was the dad in Mary Poppins. This movie is about the story of how Mary Poppins actually got made. 20 years it took for Mr. Disney to actually get the rights from P.L. Travers, who's played in the movie by Emma Thompson. Colin Farrell plays the dad, Travers himself, and we caught up with all the stars on the carpet.
To be dressed up in a suit from the 1960s and to be Walt Disney and be walking into a rehearsal hall and seeing all the accoutrements that would go along with Mary Poppins, I have to say, it was, you know, the hair stood up on the back. The fake hair stood up on the back of my head.
The great thing is, not a particularly likable woman, but you actually did make us like her from the beginning.
Well, that's the script, because she's funny.
Yeah.
I think she wasn't very funny in real life, and that's what helps. You know, you just... And also you can tell, because of Kelly's writing, that underneath that real hard exterior was something terribly vulnerable and something very wrong.
And also, love the English accent.
Oh, thanks.
Did you channel anyone for that one?
No, I mean, a little bit of this and a little bit of that. It was quite unspecific, because I was playing a man who was... Some people have said he was born in Ireland, but I believe he was born in England and then travelled to Ireland maybe a couple of times when he was 18 or 19, and then found himself in Australia when he was 20 or 21, and so his accent, by the time we meet him, is 37. He's older than that. Well, I said my own age, but anyway, he died older than that a few years. But yes, it was a mishmash, the accent. I had fairly much, you know, free rein.
Well, that's the new stars, but the stars of the original Mary Poppins movie that we all loved were there too.
I know, and the lady who won the Oscar for playing that role, Julie Andrews, was there. And an old favourite of mine, Dick Van Dyke, just absolutely marvellous. He's about 117 now, but he's still going strong. I saw him in concert out here. He was amazing. And of course, whenever we meet and we talk about Mary Poppins, you've got to talk about the incredible accent.
When I go to England or run into a Brit, I get it. I say, well, it wasn't really a Cockney accent. It was a little... area up north, you know, people from Ohio had settled there.
But the great thing is, over the years, we love it. We absolutely love it now.
I created a whole new language.
Oh, great guy. And what about the film itself then? What were they saying about that?
The film is absolutely terrific. It's definitely going to be there, thereabouts when it comes to the Oscars. Kelly Marcel, who's a Brit who actually wrote the screenplay for it, and she's now moving on to 50 Shades of Grey. What a change that is. But in case you haven't seen the movie, it's already out in Britain. It hasn't opened here yet. You're getting it first. But here's the trailer to whet your appetite once again.
Introducing the creator of our beloved Mary.
Poppins. Never, ever just Mary. Now, where is Mr. Disney?
She's here.
Now, let us begin.
She has a lot of ideas.
What kind of ideas?
Responsible's responsible.
Now, No. Responsible is not a word.
We made it up.
Well, unmake it up.
Ooh, I think that looks quite good, actually. I'm looking forward to seeing that. Now, early indication, I know it's early, but they're already talking Oscars.
Yeah, the American Film Institute has released its top 10 movies of 2013, and here is the list. Ooh. There's quite a few on there that you would imagine. There we are. Saving Mr. Banks is on the list. Yeah. Gravity, which is just terrific. 12 Years a Slave, which will be a really hard one to beat. No room there for The Butler at the moment. And of course, that was one of the early favourites. And that one, it just seems to have run out a little bit of steam at the moment. So it is surprising. But again, everything can change in the next month or two.
No, it could. Tom Hanks, Captain Phillips, got to be for me. Gets my vote. News from Mr. Simon Cowell. He's been flapping his gums. What's he been talking about?
He was on The Tonight Show. He's got two new little friends, two little dogs, Squiddly and Diddly, and he was talking about how potty trained they are, or could that be not potty trained?
Yeah. If I had a journalist come over to do an interview at my house and I was telling how well I'd been training the dogs, and then in front of the journalist one of the dogs, Squiddly, did something on the carpet.
Oh, wow.
And it wasn't a number one.
Wow. I'm surprised the journalist didn't pee on your carpet.
Has happened.
don't think it has, Simon. Ross, thank you. As always, great to talk to you. And lots more from Ross on Thursday morning with a special look at Christmas in Los Angeles. They go crazy for Christmas there.
It's Christmas. Join me, Ross King, for A-List Festive Fun right here in Tinseltown. The stars go la-la for the most extravagant gifts and deck the hills with the most outrageous decorations you'll ever see. The holiday season in Tinseltown, Thursday.
So quiet and understated in La La Land. Right, we're talking Coronation Street next after the break. And the news, well, it's going to tear Julie's life apart. Actress Katie Kavanagh is here next. Hi, welcome back. I'm going to be talking to Corey's Julie, that's actress Katie Kavanagh, in just a moment. First though, Mark Durden-Smith and Katie Nicholl are back with me. We're talking earlier about school nativity plays after a parent tried to bribe a teacher to ensure her daughter got the lead role of Mary, of course. Big response to this. Michelle Dawson says, My little boy is only three and he's a sheep. Great part. He's been practising saying ba. He's so proud of himself and I've been floods of tears watching him. I'll be very proud. Quite right, too.
Yes.
Well, Joanne from Cardiff says, my triplet daughters, my goodness, that must be hard work, are ants. And my son is a flea in this year's Christmas concert.
The great tale of the ant and the flea.
What's wrong with the traditional nativity?
I want to go to that one. Stacey Clark says, last year my son was Joseph. I couldn't have been prouder, but personally, if he's a donkey, camel or a sheep, I would be just as proud.
It doesn't matter. You watch them, you cry. It's fabulous. Claire Harvey says, my son was offered the part of narrator but turned it down and asked to be a cow because he didn't want to speak.
Kaylee Williams says, my son is a donkey in his play and to be honest, I couldn't be more proud of him. He knows his lines and he knows all the songs too. It's not about who gets the lead roles, it's the taking part.
It is, and we've also been asking, haven't we, about these rubbish cracker jokes.
Yes.
And this is from Donna in Gwent. She said, what did one snowman say to another?
Don't know.
I can smell carrots. That is your viewers' greatest joke. I mean, they're all meant to be rubbish. Well, of course they're meant to be rubbish. If they're good, they're not cracker jokes.
Exactly. Thank you both. Now, it is a big week in Coronation Street and only a matter of time before Julie discovers Brian has been deliberately sabotaging their foster application. You remember on Sunday night, Julie, still very much in the dark.
But we were talking about fostering and about why they've turned us down and not given us a proper reason. You know, the more I think about it, the stranger it seems.
Who knows how these things work? I'm more worried about you.
You don't need to worry about me.
I hate to see you disappointed, and I'm worried this wild goose chase may end in even more disappointment.
Brian, this is our future. I can't leave it like this. I have to know. I have to try.
Oh, Katie Kavanagh, who plays Julie's with me now. I've been watching this and thinking, she's so lovely. She is a lovely lady, isn't she?
She really is. Yeah.
There's not a bad bone in her body.
No.
She's an absolute sweetie pie, but sometimes you just want to shake her and say, he's just taking you for a ride, this guy.
But I mean, she's so in love with him or in love with her idea of who she wants him to be. And she's not really dealing with the reality of Brian. I don't think she's ever really dealt with the reality of Brian.
No, because the reality of Brian actually isn't all that.
No,
of course not, But it's interesting because you bounced into Corey, must be about 4 years ago?
Four
and a half years ago. So bounced in, it was only supposed to be for a short time.
Yeah.
But somehow she just kind of is, you know, we like her, we get her, we want to see more of her.
Oh, yeah, no, I've loved it. I've had such a ball playing her. She's really good fun.
She is good. That was when you started off and you were going out with Kirk.
Oh,
remember?
Yeah.
Of course you do. Remember that? And she just, like I say, she is a lovely woman. I would like to see more of her though. I'd like to see more of her. Is that something that's likely to happen?
Oh,
you think?
I mean, you never know. We never get told anything. But I hope so. I hope so. I think there's a lot more that you could discover about her, and it'd be nice to see her behind closed doors a little bit, because I think there's a real vulnerability to her, and I think she's lonely, and I think that she wants a family. She wants to be part of something.
Desperately wants that.
Yeah.
The way that she's clung on to Eileen.
Yeah.
And the
yeah.
Wants to
well,
be
now
part
Todd's
of
back, you see, so
right.
She's got someone to foster.
Funny you should mention Todd, because this is a sneaky peek at tomorrow night's episode. Have a look.
I hear you're applying for fostering again.
Yes.
Well, there's been a bit of a glitch, but who told you anyway?
Marcus.
Oh, how did he know?
Oh, Brian told him.
Oh, he never said?
No, well, he wouldn't.
What do you mean? Todd?
I think you ought to know. It's Brian. He's applied for a job in Wales.
A job in Wales? What job?
And he doesn't want to foster either. He's just been going along with it to keep you happy.
This is some kind of wind-up, isn't it?
Well, ask Brian, if you don't believe me.
Oh, dear. It's so sad. And do you know what? Now, if I thought Todd was doing that for her own, you know, for her own good, but I don't think he is.
No.
Todd's come back horrid.
But Julie thinks he is. Julie thinks he's lovely.
Oh, no.
Yeah, no. Well, he's troubled. Troubled.
Yes, maybe troubled. Yeah, troubled. That covers a whole sort of thing. Now, she's an old-fashioned girl, I would say. And that's not necessarily a criticism, but she has got some really kind of old-fashioned ideas, hasn't she?
Yeah, I think so. She's vintage. She's kind of, you know, she's a traditional girl. She's you know, she likes to cook her tea for her man and fuss him and be the kind of wife at home. And she makes her own clothes and, you know, she's into all that, Julie.
Yeah, the style sometimes, just, you know, I think with Julie, it's like, okay, stand in front of the mirror, Julie, and take one thing off. Because you've just got one thing too many on. Do you know what I mean? Just one more accessory.
When I'm sitting there and I start laughing, I go, yeah, we're good to go.
Oh, gosh.
Yeah, no, I totally agree. I think I am toning it down a little bit at the moment. She's kind of after her heartbreak, I think.
It's going to be really, really sad. I tell you what, though, Cory is just going through this amazing patch just now. You know, with all the fallout from the wedding, Roy and Hayley.
Oh,
I know. Everybody says it. Oh, don't.
It's honestly been real. Oh, it's just been, we're all still grieving. We miss her so much. And the funeral was just really, you know, because we've shot all that now.
Of
and it was heartbreaking.
But on a much brighter note, you're all going to go for your Christmas party soon, or is it been?
Oh, yes, this week, yeah.
Does everybody get really dolled up and fight to do the karaoke? Right. No, I mean, fight for the karaoke, not fight one another.
No, definitely fight for the karaoke, yeah. Cory definitely knows how to party.
Oh,
yeah.
I'd love to be a fly in the wall in that one. I bet it sounds absolutely fantastic. But I think she needs a good man.
She does.
We need to get a good man. Now, Jimmy, mystery, we saw him.